I think it's my first time of giving a talk in Nigeria. They told me that I should begin with my story. And this picture, this picture actually is the only picture that I can grab from my childhood. And part of the reason why I took to photography. At the extreme end, you know, top to the left, you know, if I can I walk down the stage? This is the stubborn guy. I said one of the reasons why I took to photography was because I was only able to grab this picture. But the second reason is this. Because I grew up in a neighborhood that teaches you all kinds of things. My parents were, they didn't belong to the middle class, I'm very sure of that. I can't say they were poor because they had vision. Vision to bring up six children. I said, if I grew up in that kind of, you know, neighborhood, and as a professional, I can't contribute to the change and development in my country, then I have no reason to exist. As a street boy in Mushi, I would go in the morning. Maybe sometimes you drop your bag somewhere and you know you never get into the class. You play football around. And you know, you come back home, maybe with one shoe, bags lost and everything. I was becoming an area boy. What do you know about area boy now? I started smoking and so my mom said, you know, that the only way she can bring me back home is to force me into learning something. Because she felt I had a flair for art. That the only way she can bring me back home is to force me to learn something, and that something was photography. Well, I took this picture in Bamako at a photo shop that belongs to one of the greatest African photographers that had ever lived. That's Malik Sidibe. If you know about Malik Sidibe, he used all these cameras. And why am I showing this? Because at that time, it was TLR, twin lens reflex camera. Because I began to learn photography with this in 1982. You see, I'm not showing these pictures just for the sake of it. I really want to show the other side of our story to inspire us, parents, even the children, that sometimes we, the parents, we do certain things sometimes when we don't even have visions. But we just do it, maybe because I want to bring this boy back home from the street, but it could just be the way he's going to go, or she's going to go. Early 2000, I began professional journalism, and I began with Daily Independent, so short a time. But within that short time, after a year or two of working, I was beaten at Tafawa Balewa Square. It was a national news. And when people say, "You police is your friend," I actually say, "No, they are not. Sorry if there's any policeman here." Because I was beaten to a pulp, just because I wanted to take the picture of the vice president. Well, the picture you are looking at now is an illegal refinery. Unaccessible. You can only fly to get this picture. Well, unaccessible to me, because those who go there by boat, by flyboat. And I was told, in the course of doing an interview with some of those, you know, people engaging in it, they told me, one of the reasons why they are doing it is to vent their angers on the Nigerian state. Well, the militancy days had gone. I have some other pictures like that too. But what is common now is what I'm showing you, you know. And you can see that everybody is angry, including you sitting here. Well, they told me that one of the reasons they are doing it is because from their land, they listen to the news every day, the money runs into billions of naira, into billions of dollars. We hear it, but we never see it. We never feel it. We never touch it. But the only way to touch it, to share part of that national revenue, is to tap into oil pipelines right inside the bush that is not accessible to any one of us. One of those stories I've covered that made me to shed tears while working. I've never shed tears. I've been a very stubborn boy. But January 2010, I shed tears because there was a gruesome killing. Sometimes these stories are far from us. We live in Lagos, we live in Abuja, and some of the politicians have never seen anything. They just talk about, okay, yeah, maybe sometime they downplay the figure so that there won't be reprisal attacks and the rest. But I've seen a lot of things, you know, in the course of, you know, moving around Nigeria to cover stories. I got this picture at that time, emotion. Some of the people were slashed from their homes because, you know, we fight for religion. This picture, you know, it seems as though I shouldn't show it. But sometimes we can't pretend that these things didn't happen. We can't just pretend because it is just too massive for us. This picture, apart from a picture that got me an award, it's also very close to my mind. Because like I said, it was at this point that I shed tears. And since thereafter, I've never. Because everybody was just crying. And as I was moving, you know, just to the burial site, this boy began to cry. And I asked myself, why was he crying? And then I looked around and I found out it was just because everybody was crying. And he was, why, what is happening? And he began to cry. And before I shot, I felt, oh my God, you know. And the water was also dropping from my eyes. In Germany, a friend of mine asked me, why is it that your country, Nigeria, is always in the news? So I said to her, I said, some of the best brains in medicine, in literature, in art, in all fields you can mention, have emerged from the shore. The richest man in Africa lives here. You know it? You don't know? No, don't mention. But I know if you go through my cocoa, like in the picture, the poorest of the black species live here. I mean, it's an extreme contradiction you cannot really pull together. So this picture tells me a lot of story of that complexities. You see a military machine gun placed in the middle. You look at it, you know, the best preacher, the best in Islamic clerics, have also emerged from here. But you don't know why we are fighting. Ask yourself, why are we fighting? You can't understand it. So I went to the church. Church burnt down. I went to the mosque. People were praying because, you know, they were fearful of reprisal attack. And I got this picture. I'm not a studio photographer. I began with studio. But, you know, because the street kept on calling me, I have my stage in Oshodi, in Ojota. My stage is always set there because our lives is full of drama. So I got this beautiful picture. Some of them look like an art piece. Of course they are. But there's a story behind it. In 2007, I was about 2 years in Reuters. And because I was so ruthless with the street to get all kinds of pictures, I got this picture, the only single picture that has taken me around the world. The only single picture. I got an award, World Press Award. It's not known yet. And because I remain very political with every picture I take, because the leadership and the vision for that direction to get Nigeria to where it's supposed to be, it's not just there. I've argued with people that when people compare Nigeria with USA, yes, they've had their democracies for over 200 years. But mind you, I think we have better opportunities. Because I've read about industrial revolutions in the US, you know, all kinds of revolutions, civil war and the rest. Well, we have fought civil wars. But the same questions, why the Civil War was fought in 1969 to 1971, are still just there. So we have to question ourselves, why is it so? Is it because of our tribe? Is it because of our ethnic? Is it because of our religion? Then which one do we have to move to get to that level? So I got this picture that looks so symbolic of a pipeline explosion in Abulegba, if you can remember the story, in Abulegba in 2006. And for me, this tells the whole package called Nigeria. Tells the story of whole package called Nigeria, because there's a particular man who is on stage, has all his belongings burnt overnight in an inferno where people were scooping petrol. And in this event, I don't want to show some of those pictures. We lost about 269, officially, we lost 269 people in that single event. Well, I tried to, you know, because I don't want to be saying, you know, sometimes people say, yeah, people say, oh, you know, I've been accused that you always see the bad things. But the police is a friend, you know. this man was waiting for the president to, you know, it's so funny that, you know, on that day, I went, this was actually taken at a Butimeta, where the president was to launch or relaunch a refurbished train, Nigerian Railway, you know. I was in that wagon, in that mummy wagon, from Lagos to Abeokuta for 2 hours, a journey that should have taken, like, if you are in Germany or in China, should have taken less than 30 minutes. But before the president came, I saw this man. It looks very humorous, because it was the first time I'm seeing a Nigerian, true Nigerian colonial police, you know, standing in front of me, and he was looking at me. He said, "You want to take my picture?" I said, "Yes." But I knew that he couldn't leave that stand. So, because he was going to beat me if he was able to leave that place. But I took his picture. But so much, I loved the color in the background. And when the president came, he dispersed and I got this picture. The other side of the story. Now, a policeman that makes you to laugh is the same policeman that is used by the same system to attack the people. I got this picture on January 3, 2012, a week before the large protest. Well, that protest for me was like playing a movie, because we were not ready. It was a good, very good drama to tell the Nigerian government that we are, you know, it can happen. But we are not ready yet. We are not ready yet. So I got this picture. They threw stone at me because I was taking this picture, and I got it. Now, look at the man in the, you know, these are the same contradictions I was talking about. We won the protest. Some people have gone to Abuja. Don't quote me. So, you know, to set you. After a week of drama, we say, oh, we are not part of that negotiation. But Nigerians, stay at home, please. Don't come out, because there could be bloodshed. But of course they were right. Because on Monday, January 16th, I saw, a week before that time, I saw a lot of cameras that I've never seen in my professional life. Because now everybody's awake to the fact that we can use photography as an art form to tell our stories. So I saw a lot of cameras. But within this period, when I was taking this picture, on January 16, we were only 5 photographers that was left to cover the protest. And in that, because these people told us we have to leave, if not, they were going to shoot us. But I said, what am I going to tell my editors? Because my editor will not listen to, maybe I shouldn't tell a story about, maybe there was a protest in Nigeria. Because my editor will not tell me there is no story. I must always produce a story. And I produced this picture, and it's very close to my heart, because it's just the contradiction of the Nigerian state. Our culture, but very strange. You know, I look for all things, because the street is my studio. You know, I keep on going back to the street. Well, don't say this is barbaric, because I saw a lot of Germans, a lot of Italians, a lot of Americans also opening up. But this is basically cultural. Well, part of our story. Well, I'm going to end with this, because I lost my mom in 2002. No, in 2004. My dad in 2002. You know, she in 2004. But also, unfortunately, the only picture I can grab from her before she left, And, several times I've said, okay, thank God for putting me on that line. Like she said, it's always good to put that legacy there, because you never can tell where, as a parent, you're going to, you know, lead your children or your child to, you know. Now today, I'm proud that I'm a good photographer. Am I good? Like she said, I don't know. That's it.